This video is sponsored by Skylum. Luminar Neo just added panoramic features, and there's some really innovative features in there that I quite enjoy. Right now we're going to have a look. And by the way, this is the first time I've ever shown Luminar on this channel. Let me know in the comments if you guys are already using it or if this is brand new, but it's definitely worth checking it out and seeing what this can do. All right, here we are inside of Luminar Neo. Let's have a look at the panoramic stitching and then we'll check out some other features. So for years now, I've been shooting aerial panoramas. Why don't we build one now? So here's a 5-image panorama that I shot at Waikiki Beach in Hawaii. So we just drag this into the panoramic stitching module here. Now to find these modules, they're under the extras. And you'll see the stitching, you just click there and it will install it. Now there's some settings, but we'll look at those in a second. What I'm going to do now is I'm just going to click start. And now it's going to bring up the images that we have here. Click continue. So one of the things I really love about this is the projections at the bottom here. You can actually drag on different parts of this image and you can just wrap it around the projection, which is really nice. It's a great way to, you know, fix it when we've got a crooked horizon and you just want to straighten that up. Now we can use different types of projections. There's a cylindrical here and, you know, we can go through all kinds. So what I'm going to do is just go back to our spherical and we'll just recenter that. And that's looking pretty good. All right, now we're going to hit continue. And this will offer us an auto crop. I might just bring that in just a little bit here into the edge there because I don't quite need it so wide. Now, if you wanted, you could go larger and fix these areas for content-aware fill inside of Photoshop later, because this will work as a plugin inside of Photoshop and Lightroom Classic. And then we're just going to hit crop and then choose save. Now we'll go in and we'll make some adjustments to this in the edit. But before we do, let's just look at a couple more things we can do with the stitching. An amazing feature is the ability to make a panorama from a video. Let me drag this video I shot with my drone into the stitching and click start. So let's grab the out point. And then we're going to grab the endpoint, and then just move this around to where we capture the pan. And if we look at that, that's pretty quick. So let's see how well it does. Hit continue. And look at that. And that's a pretty good result, especially for how fast it was panning. One of the ones that's interesting is working with multi-level panoramas. This is, you know, such as what I've got here, where I've shot in different rows. So we've got a top row, and then we've got a bottom row. So I'm just going to select them all. I'm going to grab the first one, hold down the shift key, grab the last one, and just let it sort it out. So I'm just going to drag these into the stitching. Now I'm going to start the panorama, but we're going to see a problem. And I'll show you how to fix that. All right, so here we go. Have you ever had this when you try to do a panorama and then you get issues like this mismatch? Let me just cancel that. It's really easy to fix. Just click on the options, and what we want to do is do distortion correction and de-vignette. Because sometimes when you get these mismatches, it's because of distortion around the edge of individual images. So let's just go ahead and start. We're going to restitch these again. And you'll notice this time, there's no mismatch. And of course, we can still go in here and fix the projection if it's not quite even. We can even move it around. I just think this is a pretty cool feature. And by the way, if you grab it at the edge, notice it's different than if you grab it at the middle. I'm going to stitch one more together because there's something I want to show you. So let's just drag this in and then we're going to go ahead and do some editing. So this one was shot on a Sony A1 and I'm shooting vertically here, and this is the Nepali coast in Kauai, Hawaii. So right now we're in the catalog, and as you see here, we can sort the photos, we can create folders and manually adjust them. And this is also where we have things like HDR merging, focus stacking. And by the way, the upscale actually works quite well. But what we're going to do is we're going to move in and have a look at the edits. Now there's a lot of different things here. We're obviously not going to go into all of them. And there's also a lot of AI powered. You can see the little AI there. These are all the AI powered tools here. But if you want to look for the basic adjustments, you're going to see them here under the develop. and this is generally where I'm going to start. I'm going to recover the highlights a little bit, and probably don't need to pop the shadows much on this one. Drop the exposure back a little bit. But let's look at some of these other tools. Let's look at the Enhance. And I'm just going to use the Sky Enhancer. And notice this is going to bring out some more detail here in these clouds. So maybe go even a little bit stronger. And we can apply a little accent there. Now, I generally like to keep my photos pretty realistic, so I'm not going to push these too far. Now, this also has the ability to do a sky replacement. And it has some advantages over the sky replacement in Photoshop and Lightroom, because we even have things where we can set reflections, scenery lighting. So let's get one of the things I really love about Luminar, and that's when we can go under the details here. And I remember some of these settings from some of the plugins in the Mac Fun days. So Skylum, who makes Luminar, used to be Mac Fun. So they've got quite a good heritage in making some great adjustments. And one of these I love is the ability to adjust the small, medium, and large details independently. Watch this. So the small details enable us to get very precise sharpening on very detailed areas. In fact, why don't we zoom in to make this easier to see just by simply clicking. And if we do the small details, see how this will just bring out almost like etching. So I like to give this a little bit of a boost. Now, if we look at the medium, notice what that does. Looks a little bit like what clarity would do. I don't like to get too heavy of this, but just give it a little tweak. And then we've got the large details. And if you look at that, this takes the larger area. So it's almost like tone mapping. So let's give it just a little touch there. And then sharpening. So if I click back out, and we look at this before and after, see how we can just really just get some nice details there without getting too heavy handed. Another thing I do want to show you is the denoise, but I'll use a different image for that. And then we can go under the landscape. Now we've got some nice settings here, such as golden hour, to give it a little bit more of a golden hour look. And if we look at this before and after, I'm going quite subtle. Let me show you what you could do if you were to go very heavy handed, which is a little much for me. I'm going to take it back. Since I've been playing with this, one of the things I do like is the color harmony. So we can just give it a little push of warmth here and watch what we get. So instead of having it oversaturated, we can go the other way and get a pretty realistic looking result there. Maybe not off so much. There we go. Another interesting option is dodge and burn. So if we go here, we can lighten and darken. So unfortunately, this doesn't have pan pressure. So if you're using your Wacom, you're just going to have to set your strength pretty low, which is what we'll do here. Let's start with a darken. I'm going to take the strength down really, really low. And let's increase the size. One of the things I do like is you get a preview of the cursor. That's great. And with a very low strength, I'm just going to paint in the sky here just to kind of give us a little bit of a vignette effect. Darkening the sky. And I'm also going to do the same thing with the foreground. And let's go for lighten. Keep that strength really, really low and just build it up. Let's just lighten up our main part of the subject. And if we look at this image, here we are before and after. Nice set of adjustments there. I did mention I want to show you a couple of other things. By the way, I added 72,000 photos to test this, and it seems to be handling quite well. So what I want to do is I just want to change this to capture by edit time so we can see the images that I've edited down at the bottom. All right, here we are in edit. And by the way, we have all kinds of things that we can work with layers and masking. We've got AI powered masks. But what I want to do here is I just want to remove my shadow here from this panorama. So let's go under erase. Let's make the brush a little bit bigger. I'm just going to select my shadow. And then click erase. And as you can see there, it does a good job. If we want to get rid of some smaller areas, such as these other tourists, let's leave one person there for scale. We can hit erase. And as you can see there, it handles that very nicely. All right. What I want to show you here is noise reduction. So let's just go into the develop module, and I'm going to open up the exposure on this. All right. And if we zoom in close, you can see that that noise is just absolutely ridiculously bad. So we're going to use the noiseless extension. And the advice is saying, let's use the middle. Okay, let's do it. Let's just use the middle. And it uses AI to reduce that noise. And you can see this has really cleaned it up and made this usable. And of course, we could choose a low amount if we preferred that. So a couple of other adjustments I made. So one of this is going from a really bad photo for a lot of atmospheric haze and stuff going on. And yep, I was able to clean that up pretty easily. And then there's another one I just did of some quick portraits at a trade show. And if we look at this before and after, it did a nice job of restoring everything, getting good skin tones and everything. And here's one where I did the sky replacement and the colorizing. That was the photo before and after. And another panorama where I did a little bit of dodging and burning. If we look at the before and after, particularly if you look over here on Diamond Head, you can see where that dodging and burning worked quite nicely. So the guys at Skylum are offering a 10% discount to Photoshop Cafe subscribers. Just use Photoshop Cafe as the code, and there's a QR code and a link in the description of where you can go to the page and purchase it. And if you don't want to do a subscription and you want to own your software outright, just scroll down on the page, and then they have perpetual licenses where you can do a one-time purchase. So let me know in the comments underneath if you guys have ever used Luminar before, or if this is brand new to you, and what are your thoughts on it? If you're new, hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.